There is a whole lot to talk about, not the least of which is that the cold snap is supposed to be over in California. 5 days of hard freeze, 28 or below. Many places quite a bit below that, and a lot of damage, citrus, etc. So, but now it's supposed to be warming up, and so I'm saying, yes, great. Let's put that in the rearview mirror. So many things to get to here. What's most important is to make a very, very significant report. And that is, I was able this morning to engage my mind with the rationale behind high indifference, is what I call it. It may be a shock to you that on the spiritual path, you don't necessarily like your spiritual mentors, not all the time. I've been spiritually mentored for a long time, maybe 35 years along those lines. And just because I have these really great spiritual mentors doesn't mean I always like them. I don't, no. A lot of time I'm not kind of angry with them. But I do love the teaching. I do love the teaching, really. I don't think I've ever really been mad at the teaching. The teaching's great. But the thing is, I don't understand the high indifference. I have not of these spiritual mentors. There's something that is, you know, is kind of infuriating about it, because a lot of times I feel like they don't even care about me. They're just so indifferent. They don't care. That's what I'm feeling like. Wow, how come you're not helping me? And yet the teaching is great. It's really good, but their attitude is again almost inscrutable. So I was finally able to take a look at that, and lo and behold, I was able to engage my mind with this and begin to look at it and turn it around this way and that way. And I began to loosen it all up. I was able to see what high indifference is really about. It was this incredible accomplishment. So I want to report to everyone that it is possible. It's possible for us right here in this world, with all the troubles we have and the times that we're having, for you to literally engage and understand high indifference. And that's a milestone, really. A true milestone. So I reached that milestone. I had a dream before that, where I was backtracking on the path that I'd been. I was like backtracking, trying to get back, which is what I'm really doing. I'm trying to get back to full sanity, as it were. And across the path, as we were going, like it was like through a jungle, a savanna land, and partial, a lot of trees and jungle, and then some savanna land, and there was this enormous hippopotamus lying across the path, and we couldn't get through. And I had a couple of friends who, I imagine those are my spiritual mentors, were able to get the hippopotamus up and get it moving out, and it walked right past me. I was standing there, and I was just like, I wasn't petrified, but I was just saying, holy cow, look at the size of that hippopotamus. It's gigantic. It was like 10 feet high and just as much wider than that. It was just an enormous creature. It was just slowly walking right past me. I was just standing right there. Oh, I said, oh boy, I hope it doesn't crush me. It did not. We were able to move the hippopotamus out of the way. And there was also this enormous lion, male lion, just watching this whole thing. Just watching. I said, whoa, what's that lion going to do? Fortunately, nothing. It symbolized the removal of an enormous obstacle. And then in the morning time, I usually do my best work, and I wake up in the morning early and just lie there still and give 100% concentration to the mental processes and examining what are the obstacles, what are the difficulties, and just looking with the mind and looking at it and turning it this way and that, examining it, trying to get insight into it, because I'm not asleep, but I'm not fully awake either, and my eyes are closed, and I'm not focusing on anything in the room or anything in the environment, anything in the world, no thought whatsoever for the external world, but not in the dream state either, not sleeping, but just focusing very quietly and intently on trying to loosen up the fear and the concerns that arise. You can see in the mind is troubled by some stuff. So that's when I was able to engage with high indifference. Now, it's possible to talk about it. I've been trying to for quite some time. It's possible to get even clearer about talking about this. Why do the spiritual mentors seem to have this incredible aloofness, indifference. It's just like we don't understand, and it gets us infuriating at times. So, but really, it's for our own benefit. It is for our own benefit, but we don't see it. We don't see it. It's difficult to see, and it is. It was. I was able to do it, and it didn't cause any problems, and I said, well, I can do it. But a tremendous amount of work has gone into getting to this point where we're able to engage with that higher indifference and see what's really going on. It has to do with hypotheticalness, the whole nature of what a hypothetical, what's going on with hypotheticals. That is the key to the whole thing, which is why I keep raising this issue of the hypothetical scenario. It's super important to understand the remedy. You have to recognize that we are simply dealing with a hypothetical. Some say like a dream, but hypothetical is more accurate. It says, what if this were possible? For example, what if you had a hypothetical that it was possible to fall into a pit and suffer terribly in this deep, dark pit? Okay? And, so you are imagining that you're going through this experience because you're going through what if this could happen, and then you're imagining that it is happening. Yet you're not really in the pit. You're not. What you are is not really there. In reality, you're not in the pit. You're imagining what if you could be. That's a hypothetical. Now, let's say you're trying to climb out of this pit. Terrible suffering, just unbelievable suffering in there, and you're desperately trying to, and you get up to the edge of the pit, and you're pulling yourself up, you got your head over the edge, and you're trying to grab hold of the ground, you're scratching at it, trying to get some traction, and then you look up, and there's a being there who's totally peaceful, totally blissful and serene, and they're just looking straight ahead, they're just there, calmly there. And you say, help, 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 grab my hand, help, please, pull me out, I don't want to ever be in this pit again, it's horrible. And the being doesn't do anything, it just stands there very serenely, it doesn't do anything. And you say, what are you doing? I'm starting to slip back, pull me out. They don't do anything. And then gradually you slide down the walls of the pit, and your hand slips off the edge of the pit, and you go back into the pit like the mosh pit, this horrible dark mosh pit with depthless suffering and misery and darkness. And you say, that's incredible. One, you saw someone who was not in the pit, and they were totally serene and blissful. It was like, say, I want to be that. That's what I want to be that way. I want to be out of the pit and serene and blissful. And yet they didn't do anything to help you. They didn't grab your hand and pull you out. That's literally the experience I had, just like that. And so, of course, I was furious. I said, what's going on? Yeah, I wouldn't know what to make of the situation. Why wasn't I pulled out? And this has been a conundrum for 35 years. Why wasn't I pulled out of the pit? Finally, this morning, I finally understood why. It has totally to do with the nature of hypotheticals. Because, let's say you get pulled out of the pit. Remember, the pit is just a hypothetical. So, within this hypothetical, the nature of this hypothetical being what it is what if reality could be changed, and we're trying to figure out a way to survive this change of reality, which would be annihilation. And the dynamics keep putting us through challenges, annihilation challenges, all this suffering and misery. So what if this being pulled you out of the pit in this hypothetical? What would happen is that you would immediately say, you would hear, like, you would decide, and this notion would arise within your mind, and you say, well, what if I fall back in the pit? Okay? Immediately. You say, what if I fall back in the pit? You say, oh my gosh. And you say, oh my gosh, the pit's still there. I could fall in at any moment. What if I fall back in? And so your mind is still agitated and worried. And you say, you know, I need to find some way to be happy in the pit, because I could, even if I get out, I could fall back in. So what if I fell back in? In other words, the hypothetical is still in force. What if is still in force? So you're not really saved from the pit at all. You're not saved from your anxiety. You're not saved from your trepidations. You don't have peace of mind, because it's always think, what if I wasn't, or you could say, what if I wasn't pulled out? What if there wasn't anyone there? Then what then? What if I couldn't get out? You know, all this, well, sure, someone pulled me out, but what if they didn't? In other words, you're still in the grip of this hypothetical, and you're still then totally at the mercy of this hypothetical. What this being does, this totally serene being, is simply what they're showing you is, what if you didn't need any hypotheticals? That's a hypothetical too. But they're saying, listen, hypotheticals are totally at your discretion. You can choose whatever hypothetical you want. It's all unreal anyway. It's all equally unreal. All hypotheticals are equally unreal. None of them are real. Have no basis in reality whatsoever. So it's totally at your discretion. You're capable of simply saying, well, what if I don't need any hypotheticals? See? Or what if reality can never be changed? Meaning, I don't need any hypothetical. I don't need a contingency plan, hypothetical and contingency plan. You can say that. What if I don't need any hypotheticals at all? Well, you certainly then don't need any hypothetical pit, do you? So literally, in that hypothetical, you don't need hypotheticals. So you don't need a hypothetical pit. You don't need a hypothetical falling into the pit. You don't need a hypothetical pulling out of the pit. You don't need hypotheticals at all. And that is truly the remedy. You see, what if I didn't need any hypotheticals? So that is what this teacher, this spiritual mentor, was showing me. But it's taken me 35 years to understand it. And yet they were right. They were right. See? And because I love the teaching so much, this upset to the spiritual mentors, you know, I put up with it. You might think, oh, I just love Jesus Christ, or I love Ananda Maima. No, that's not true. Really, I've been very upset with them many times because it doesn't seem like they are helping, really. they're so inscrutable. It's very difficult to understand. How come they don't help us? And I know a lot of people feel the same way about God. How come God doesn't help us? Well, God is really not in this hypothetical situation at all. It's our deal. It's the sonship. God gave the Holy Spirit to the situation, and then that's it. Because God knows that it's all completely unnecessary, totally unnecessary. But the grace of God, the blessing upon all this, does provide spiritual mentors for us, which are part of the sonship, which is spirit. God the Son, as it were. But God the Father is not involved directly at all. God, so there's total indifference there, really. Almost a total indifference. But then the spiritual mentors, they're here working with us, helping us, and yet they have this high indifference. And it just seems so inscrutable. And we can't quite, we can't relate to it. It's very difficult. And so, no, the spiritual mentors are useful, they're helpful, but we don't necessarily love the spiritual teachers, and that's not the point. The point is to get the teaching. Okay, it's not to worship the teachers, it's not to say how much you love them, it's to get the teaching. They want to be one thing, and they want to, what is that? They want to be useful. They want to be useful. That's it. They don't care if you love them or not, that's not the point. And they know you won't. I mean, gosh, I mean, I'm sure Jesus has heard an earful from me, I tell you. Because I'm not timid. I'm not so timid when it comes to giving him an earful about saying I don't feel like he's doing a very good job. Really. I'll really chew him out. Because I know he's capable. I know he's there. I know all that, but he doesn't seem to be doing a very good job. That's how I look at it. Because the difficulty of this hypothetical causes us severe problems. It's difficult for us to get it clear, to get it straight. But what can he do? If he tries to act as if this hypothetical is real and you really need to be pulled out and protected from the pit, that is really actually going to delay your success. It's going to cause a severe problem for you. Because you won't then even think along the lines of choosing another hypothetical. You won't see, you'll think that this hypothetical is it. And somehow I have to be happy within this context and go from this one's back, straight back to reality. It'll cause enormous problems. So Jesus knows he cannot teach that way. He cannot pull us out of the pit. And that's why we look in the world and it's so easy to lose faith in the world, right? Because of all the terrible stuff that's happening, and it is. Let's make no mistake about it. In that pit, it's absolute hell. Because we're in it, and we know. But it's a hypothetical. What if this were possible? But if all this were possible, it's not possible in reality. It's totally not possible. None of this can happen in reality. But we're saying, well, what if it could? So that, we are suffering horribly, and it's going to get a lot worse. A lot worse. So we're desperate to get out of that pit, right? The attempts to bring happiness within the pit end up becoming worse than the misery we're suffering previously. The attempt to impose some sort of righteous solution within the pit actually makes things worse. It really does. And yet all this is done in the name of Jesus or in the name of so-and-so, thinking that surely this is what Jesus wants. It's not true. It's not true. If you come across the true Jesus, you'll experience this high indifference. And he will not even try to help you in the way that you think you should be helped. He won't pull you out of the pit. Will not. That's the true Jesus. The fake ones that we're imagining. We say, well, what if Jesus were this way? And he's desperately trying to, come on, come out of that pit. I'm trying to pull you out of there. I'm going to jump in the pit, and I'm going to make you all happy in the pit. Not true. Not true at all. In fact, Jesus is looking there. He doesn't see any pit at all. He says, what if there were no pit? What if there were no pit? What if we didn't need hypotheticals? What if there were no hypotheticals? That's what Jesus is seeing and showing you. It's possible to have this hypothetical. So what he's saying, you're not in the pit. There is no pit to get into. And you could never have a pit or get into any such pit in his hypothetical. Because he's saying, well, what if we didn't need hypotheticals at all? See? And then none of that is possible. None of the suffering would be possible. So that's how we're healed. Is choosing a hypothetical where none of this, or sickness, all this stuff's not even possible. That is the way. And that's not a way that we are searching for. We're searching for the answer in all the wrong places. All the wrong places. And that can go on and on and on. And you have to be very determined on the spiritual path. Spiritual path is not for dilettantes. It's for those who are very determined. I suffered so bad with that chaos, that which is the very lowest point that's possible to get, is total chaos. The mind experiencing total chaos is the worst suffering that is possible. There is no worse suffering than that. And I reached that point, and it was so terrible that hopefully this keeps recording. It just dropped out. So terrible that I was just completely determined that I'm going to find a way to get free of this. I never, ever, no possibility I could ever experience this again. So literally, I've not taken a day off in 35 years. I've been spiritually mentored for all that 35 years, and I've never taken a single day off. And I've just gone full blast the entire time from sheer determination. I still have that determination. I do never want to experience that again. It was too terrible. And all the rest of it too, the depression, anxiety, too terrible. No way, I'm going to be free of it, and free of it forever, with no possibility of going back to it. Theoretically, of course, we could always choose again the wanting to be prime creator, and that would bring us right back to it. But once you realize what it entails, you're not going to do that. You will not do that at all. So, it's as good as never. And so I remain completely determined. And every day I get up, and whatever my determination seems to lag, I just say, hey, do I want to go back to what I've been through? And it just like shocks me. It's like shock therapy. It says, no way. No way do I want to go what I've been through. No way. So I am completely determined to get free, absolutely free. And I've seen how to do it now. I've seen how to do it. It's you do exchange hypotheticals. That is the way. And you don't pull yourself out of the pit. You choose a hypothetical where there couldn't be any pit, because you choose the hypothetical of what if we didn't need hypotheticals. So the hypothetical pit, you say, I don't need that hypothetical. So it's not there. I don't need to choose that hypothetical. It's just like a dream. In a dream, you can choose any dream you want. But choose the dream of saying, I don't need to have any dreams. I don't really need to have any dreams. And then it gives you this total serenity and peace and calm and bliss. It's the happy dream. The happy dream is the dream that you don't need any dreams. You don't need to continue dreaming. What if I didn't need any hypotheticals? What if hypotheticals were not necessary? And of course, they're not necessary, because reality cannot be changed in any way. So there's never going to be any need for any hypotheticals. Never. That is the remedy. So Jesus does know the way. the spiritual mentoring I've received has been accurate, has been right. It's just a difficult climb to see that, even though you intuit it. It's like my mind is like saying, you know, it doesn't seem fair, does it? We want it to be fair. And say, what? We want to be helped out of the pit. We want to be calmed and soothed in the pit. And we want remedies in the pit. There aren't any. There aren't any remedies in the pit. It's all hypothetical. Let's say you get healed. Remember, you get healed from cancer. You say, oh, that's great. And then a minute later, you say, well, wait a minute. What if it comes back? What if it comes back? Like, there goes your bliss. Gone. It's not stable. It is not stable at all. There's no stability within a hypothetical of that nature. What if we didn't need hypotheticals? That's stable. See, that is stable. Because the hypothetical, what if we did, is a different hypothetical. Different hypothetical law. Because you're saying, well, what if we don't need hypotheticals at all? How would that be? Whereas if you decide we do need hypotheticals, then you're at the mercy. You're really at the mercy of what if. So no matter how much you're healed, you say, well, what if it comes back? What if I fall back into the pit? Then what? So you can be pulled out of a pit a million times and it won't do you any good. Because you'll say, well, what if I fall back in? So that's not salvation at all. It is not. So we have a false expectations of what salvation is, which is why we have so much trouble to discover what it really is. So much trouble. Good grief. Removing the obstacles is an arduous thing. So what kept me going was just that the suffering I had experienced was so severe that I was just I've been absolutely determined to never re-experience it and be certain of it. Not 99% certain, 100%. 99 to me is nothing, really. 99.9 is nothing. Only 100%. That's it. That's the only goal I ever had was 100% certainty. Nothing less. I never aimed at anything less than that. So that gives you the push you need. So when I look at this at high indifference, I'm not saying, gee, this is too tough. I'm saying, I'm going to get this if it takes me forever. I'm going to get it. There's no question of not getting it at all. I just saying, well, I'm going to keep trying until I get it. Period. No possibility of giving up. There's never been any possibility of giving up on the path. None. Of course, I get really mad at times, for sure. Very frustrated, just because I just can't get it. Don't get it. Yeah, so. But it is absolutely possible to get it. I was able to engage with it, mentally engage with it, and it didn't cause me any trouble. I was sort of like, wow. But it was like very amazing to be able to think in those terms. I've never been able to think in those terms before like that. To literally see the slipperiness of hypotheticals, of how slippery they really are, what a slippery slope it is, and how we don't realize how slippery it is. We keep thinking that we're saved, and then we say, well, what if we're not saved? See? So it's always possible to say, well, what if I were saved? And then say, well, what if I weren't saved? You're not really getting free of hypotheticals that way. That's just playing mind games. It's possible to play mind games, but that's not the answer. That is not the answer. So it takes a certain kind of tremendous determination to find the answer. And the reason why I got such great mentors, spiritual mentors, as like Jesus Christ and Sri Anandamaya Ma, was because I was so super determined. So they must have known. They said, hey, here's the request is coming in for someone who's super determined. So that it's the request is the deservedness. We think, well, how do I deserve spiritual mentoring? Well, by requesting it, you deserve it. That proves that you're deserving of it because you're requesting it. It's not like, that is how it goes. So I requested it, and I requested the best. I requested the very best. I said, I am going to succeed 100%, no quit in me, no way. And then I ended up getting the best spiritual mentoring because of that 100% determination. So that's how it works. That is how it works. So don't be afraid to make the request. As soon as you make the request, that means you deserve it. You deserve it. Now, you may not have the same level of determination, or you might. You might. But ultimately, everybody is going to, seems like, experience that chaos, mental chaos, because they're trying to reconcile mutual exclusives. And the reconciling of mutual exclusives is total chaos. That's how it has to be symbolized. There's no other way. So I was determined to find some way to help the world. And so I tried to reconcile mutual exclusives, because that was the only thing the world understands. That's the only thing the ego understands. Ego doesn't understand anything other than that. And the world is so devoid of true teaching and true understanding that it just seems like that's the only possible remedy. But that leads to a mental state of total chaos. So it was compassion that led me to the total chaos. And I said, wow, I want to keep my compassion, but I absolutely am not going back there. That is for sure, ever. So now, and then I got a dose of true compassion, which was this high indifference. And I've been struggling to understand, well, how does that help? You know, it just seems really very tough nut to crack. But now it's being cracked. You crack the nut and you look inside and you say, I finally cracked that nut. I thought, I don't know when that would ever happen. But it's been cracked. It's been cracked. Now I know I can do it. And you don't know until you try. You don't know until you try. Say, I'm gonna try. Now Sri Ananda Maha had that high indifference, and just it puzzled everybody. I mean, it was super difficult. People just couldn't crack that nut. They didn't understand why. Why is she that way? Is this just, did they say she's wonderful? But there's always that but. And people said, we just can't quite get it. We just don't get it. And then even the people closest to her, they didn't get it. They didn't get it. And she said, not many really got it. Not many really got it. It's a tough nut to crack. Why the high indifference? But it is crackable. Absolutely is crackable. And it's not difficult for the mind. It's not. It doesn't overwhelm the mind at all. It's just simply you're looking in a different direction for the answer. That's all. That's all it is. It's not like you're jumping through hoops or something. You're just saying, you're just entertaining a different remedy than what you expected. That's all. That's all it is. You say, you mean there is no remedy for getting out of the pit? I mean, I'll never be pulled out? No, no, there's no remedy for that. You mean I'll never be happy in this pit? No. But you'll choose a hypothetical where you don't see yourself in the pit at all. Because it can't happen. You're not entertaining that hypothetical. So you're not saying, well, what if I was in the pit? You're saying, well, what if I wasn't entertaining any hypothetical? Which then reflects reality. It's like a mirror reflecting reality. So it's all a matter of looking in where the answer is. Because when you look for where it isn't, it becomes very difficult, doesn't it? Ultimately becomes impossibly difficult. And if you're really determined and you keep looking where the answer isn't, which is what I did, you get these mutual exclusives, which is what the ego assumes that has to be the answer. What the ego says is those who believe they can be free are insane. Okay, if you come in here and you teach the truth, the ego will say you're completely insane. Then the ego will say, if you want to really reach anybody, you've got to be cured of your insanity. And you say, well, ego, how can I reach people here? And the ego says, well, you've got to find, you've got to both have sanity and insanity. If you don't want to get rid of your insanity, then you have to have both insanity true and insanity true, as it were. Your insanity, which is really truth, and then the ego's sanity, which is really insanity. They have to both be true. You have to integrate them into one whole thing, and that's the ego tells you. Then when you do that, everybody will be able to understand what you're saying. So when you try to do that, you reach a state of complete chaos, mental chaos. There's not a physical thing. See, physical afflictions are bothersome, painful, but they're nothing compared to the mental afflictions, nothing at all. Piece of cake. And the mental afflictions are truly terrifying. And when you have the ultimate mental affliction, which is total chaos, it's completely terrifying. Completely terrifying. And it leaves a scar, a mark, as it were, a mark of determination within you. So But the fact is, once you decide you don't need to entertain any hypotheticals at all, not only is there no pit there, not only is there no confusion, no chaos, no depression, there's no sickness there at all. You're free of suffering, literally free of suffering, all suffering. You are totally free of suffering, forever. Will never come back on you. No possibility, because it's only hypothetical, and you decided, what if you don't need any hypotheticals, which is true, and that reflects reality, and you get reassured, reality can't be changed. I don't need any hypotheticals. So when you crack this nut of high indifference and see the utility, the usefulness of it, you're literally talking about being free of all suffering. That's it. Period. Suffering really comes upon us because it's like a bargain we're making with the ego, because we're so afraid of this chaos, mental chaos. We're so terrified with it. We say to the ego, "Hey, ego, we don't want to go there. Can you forestall this somehow?" And the ego will say, "Sure, you can get this sickness or this sickness or this sickness." And so it's the leverage the ego has upon you to bring about all level affliction. Of course, the ego is just imaginary too. It's only hypothetical. There is no ego, actual ego. We're bringing all this upon ourselves. But we are literally willing to die 1,000 deaths rather than experience just a moment of total chaos. That is true. And not only 1,000 deaths, but all the misery and suffering of existence. And we do that. We literally do that. And I reached a point where I said, "I'm not taking any more births, period. So whatever the problem is, I'm going to solve it now." And then so I went and had the experience of this total chaos. And then I said, I saw, wow, yeah. I mean, anyone would rather have 1,000 lives and go through all the suffering and sickness and death than have that experience. No question about it. But I said, you know, I'm tired of that, so I'm going to figure out what the problem is here, period. But sure, I mean, if you think you're free of existence, anyone thinks they're free of existence, they're just making a bargain. They'll die, they'll go to the afterlife, they'll be reborn, and they'll suffer, and they'll die again. All this stuff keeps going on because you haven't got out of the hypothetical at all. You haven't realized the nature of hypothetical and how to get free of it. And so, and you're terrified of experiencing that mental chaos, and so you keep making bargains. So every life is just a bargain that you're bargaining with. You're just bargaining, saying, "Hey, if I have this, maybe I can avoid the something worse." When we look at happiness in this world, it's relativistic. Nobody's really happy except those who have chosen the hypothetical of not needing any hypotheticals. Only they are truly happy. The rest of us, our happiness is really saying, is a type of relief that it isn't worse. That is literally all the happiness in the world is literally just that. We have this sense of like, "Oh my gosh, I'm so glad that things aren't a lot worse for me. They could be a lot, lot worse. So I'm happy." I mean, not really happy. You're relieved that things aren't worse. That's it. So it's ridiculous to search for happiness within that context at all. There's no absolute happiness within this context at all, within this hypothetical of what if reality could be changed. There's no happiness in that. Never will be. Never will be. We're just relieved that we're not suffering total chaos in our mind. And, you know, when I pulled away from that and started to begin clarifying, I was very relieved. I said, "Oh my gosh, I'm so much better." Even though I was suffering still insanely bad, just horribly, I was still saying like, "Hey, it could be a lot worse." So I had some of that relativistic happy. I think this could be a lot worse. I could be back where I was before. My gosh, how blessed I am. I felt really blessed. So we feel blessed in this world simply because we realize it could be a lot worse. And that's the best that we can ever hope for in this situation, which is, you know, crumbs. It is crumbs. And we don't have to settle for crumbs. We obviously don't have to settle for crumbs, and yet we do over and over and over and over again. And if we don't get that determination, then we will continue to try to make bargains with quote unquote the ego. The ego is just an imaginary bargainer. It's really we're just deceiving ourselves, but we think that we'll make a better bargain if we just imagine there's some deceiver there, the ego, that we can bargain with and get a good bargain from the ego. Then we say, "See, I'm smart. See, I outsmarted the ego. I made a good bargain this time," and that gives us this false sense of hope. False sense of hope. Now the total lack of understanding is still there. And so that the possibility you will go into this total mental state of total chaos for an instant, a moment, only can last a moment, is still there. It's completely in play, totally in play, because you will, at some point you will feel you need to make both truth and lies true. You have to reconcile it. Mutual exclusives. The whole idea is that the ego says the only way to be saved is to reconcile mutual exclusives. It's the only way the ego knows about. The only way. And to do that will brings you down. Brings you down ultimately to a moment of total mental chaos. And then instantly you realize that's the bottom. And you can't go any lower. And you're still here. So there's no resolution. No magic happened. Nothing. So you see, oh my gosh, I got nowhere to go but up from there, that's for sure. But there's also a recognition at that point that there's some way to get free of it. Because you say, wait a minute, there's something phony about this whole thing. This isn't it. And you get a glimpse like there is an answer. And you think you need to go up out of the pit, but you don't really need to. You need to choose a different hypothetical where there is no pit. So there's no need to struggle to get out of the pit. You don't need to reconcile mutual exclusives. You don't need to reconcile reality and hypotheticals. You don't. Hypotheticals never be real. Reality will never be hypothetical. You don't need to reconcile it. But the ego, that's the only way the ego knows. So the ego has a false plan of salvation that leads to life after life after life and death after death after death, suffering after trauma after trauma after trauma. It's all that it does. And you're bargaining all the time with this imaginary ego so you don't go all the way down and hit rock bottom. And then you think you've led a good life. And you, whew, you finish life and you're like, oh. That's what happens when people pass away. They say, oh my gosh, I had a pretty good life. And you know, they're kind of like, yeah, it was. I had some good moments. It wasn't so bad. It wasn't so bad. It wasn't as bad as it could have been. It wasn't as bad as it could have been. And that's what they mean. They mean I avoided it again. I avoided bottoming out again. And they think that's success. If I can just avoid bottoming out forever, things will be okay. Not true. You're still completely unclear about the fact you're in a hypothetical and you don't know how to deal with it. So you're just complete, still totally in this cycle. And at some point, you'll get so fed up with it that you will be determined to get free. And then you will bottom out for a moment. And then you will ask for the help. And then you will get it. And then you'll be spiritually mentored to the point where you will recognize the nature of hypotheticals and how to truly deal with it. And then you will eventually be a part of the mentoring process, spiritually mentoring process. Part of God's plan of salvation requires spiritual mentoring. We help one another. But truly, we're not helping one another when we're trying to pull each other or boot each other out of the pit. That's not the way. That is not the way. And it's super difficult for us to recognize this. So you won't always like your spiritual mentors, no way. Jesus said those who come to help in his name will be hated by the world, really. A lot of people hate him. And even those who are being helped get angry, get very angry. Like I have many times. I've called them all sorts of names. That's completely incompetent. You're completely incompetent. Like that, really. And worse stuff too. But that's pretty bad, you're completely incompetent. Because you're not pulling me out at all. Which is true, he's not been pulling me out at all. But he's showing me I don't need to be pulled out. That's not the answer. Because it's all what if I was in the pit, but I'm not actually in the pit. So therefore I can just as easily say, well, what if I don't need any hypotheticals at all? It's just another hypothetical. Nothing stopping you, anyone from entertaining that one. Nothing at all. It's our choice. But we think we need this hypothetical. We need a contingency planning in case reality were destroyed. We need this contingency plan. So we're terrified. See, no, we have to succeed with this. We have to succeed. The pit, we have to say, well, no, the pit is real, but we have to make sure we get out of it and don't fall in again. How do we do that? In other words, the pit symbolizing this annihilation of reality, and us getting out of the pit is surviving the annihilation somehow. And we say, well, what if it all were real? How will we survive? How will we be happy? That's not the way. That is not the way. It's not real. It can never be real. Reality is invulnerable. There's no pit to fall into there. So it will always only be hypothetical. So you have to deal with hypotheticals with another hypothetical. That's the only way to deal with it. You can't make illusions real and then find the remedy to that. It's impossible. What you do is you try to then reconcile mutual exclusives, and you get the depression, and you get ultimately the mental chaos. And that is no picnic, really. I mean, that's stunning. The suffering can be stunning. It can be so terrible. The physical suffering, again, it's just nothing. You're not getting compared. It's apples and oranges, apples and oranges. Anyone who's suffered from mental distress knows what I'm talking about. It's apples and oranges. No one has any idea, really, unless you've been there. You don't have any idea of what, like, total chaos. No one has any idea unless they've actually experienced that. And you see no hope there whatsoever. You see zero hope, zero. No remedy ever. You feel that you are eternally damned, really. It's like you feel like you're in hell and there's no escape. You're eternally damned, and you're just suffering complete torture at every moment, and there's no remedy whatsoever, et cetera, et cetera. You get that you get that in a full dose, and then you pull back from that and say, I don't want that. And you say, wait a minute, what said I don't want that? What is it that said I don't want that? What is that? See? You say, someone's entertaining a hypothetical. Interesting. So you get a kind of glimpse. And the ego will then starts to call you all sorts of names, comes furious at you. Because you pulled back from its most valuable prize, which is this total chaos, is the ego's remedy. That's the ego's ultimate prize of the ego's plan of salvation, is the total mental chaos, and you've pulled back from it, so the ego gets furious with you. It says that you're completely incompetent, you're completely stupid, you'll never succeed, you're the worst person ever, you're nothing. And just that's what I got, just furious denunciation, because I pulled back from its great prize, and it doesn't have anything else really to offer. That's its goal. That's its ultimate goal. If I reject its ultimate goal, it knows that I'm going to end up rejecting its total plan altogether eventually. So it was very displeased with me, to say the least. Very displeased. There was great displeasure there. Shocking displeasure, really. And I just said, hey, I'm not that bad. I'm not that stupid. No, I'm not total failure, you know. At least I rejected this total chaos, so I'm not a total failure. At least I was wise enough to reject that. So, and then the ego knows that its time is limited when that happens. Again, the ego's imaginary. There is no ego there. Yet we presume, for it's very useful for us to presume there is one there. But we're really denouncing ourselves, saying, what we're essentially saying is that we have to succeed with this contingency plan, and you have decided that you cannot succeed. That's like super, super terrible for you. You're going to be annihilated. So I need to really denounce you to try and shock you back into accepting this total chaos. We try to do this to ourselves. We feel we need this plan. We need a contingency plan in case reality is annihilated. And why? What's the root? We want to be prime creator. We chose the idea. We want to be prime creator. That would necessitate a change in reality, right? Because we're not prime creator. We are the prime created. To be prime creator, we'd have to complete, reality would have to cease to exist as it is, totally, totally. The change, it would annihilate it entirely. So that's why we are entertaining this hypothetical and saying we must find out a way to survive. And so this total mental chaos is like symbolizing annihilation. And the ego then wants us to somehow be happy with that. And it's impossible to be happy with that. It is impossible. That's what I discovered. It's impossible. We cannot. Spirit cannot be happy with that. Spirit recognizes, saying, I can never be happy with this. That is impossible. So you recognize the impossible at that point. And then the ego's days are numbered. You're going to listen. And I said, hey, is there some other plan? I need a plan. I need help. And then I got the spiritual mentoring from that point on. Got the Holy Spirit, got Jesus, and then got Ananda Maima. They come in and they help. They're helping behind the scenes. They're guiding in some way that's mysterious to us. The path is very mysterious. Really, there's no way anybody can explain the path, especially as you're going along it. You cannot understand it or explain it. Because it doesn't seem like you're getting the kind of help that you would expect. You think, hey, I need to do this, and I'm not getting the help. What's the big deal? What's going on? Are you guys incompetent? What's going on? But somehow they're working you towards recognizing the nature of the situation that you're in. It's a hypothetical. and how to truly deal with that situation in the way that actually works. So all praise to the spiritual mentors, and yet is the usefulness that they're looking for. They're not looking for any praise, they're looking for success. And to see that, to get useful and actually succeed, that's the only point of it all. So we don't need to spend our time in worship and praise and gratitude. We need to spend our time in clarification. That's the hard work. Anybody can jump up and down and chant and yell and do all that stuff. That's kindergarten stuff. Really, the tough stuff is to mentally to work on clarification and to take on these challenges, like moving that hippopotamus in the dream. Are you kidding me? Who would even think about trying to do that? You see, it was just like this enormous obstacle. I looked at it, I said, "Oh, how in the we're finished. How can we move that hippopotamus? This is just terrible." And I got some help. I had two helpers who prodded the hippopotamus, did something to kind of get the hippopotamus up and moving, because the hippopotamus didn't want to move. Lazy, just sitting there. Had no desire to move whatsoever, and we were able to move it out of there. But that takes, you know, it takes focus, determination, etc. So clarification is work. It's not, it's like getting the lunch pail. You gotta be blue collar on the spiritual path. You gotta be a blue collar worker, period. It's not glamorous at all. It's not glamorous. Get up in the morning, get your lunch pail, you go to work. You do your work, you work hard, you come home, you get some rest so you can get up in the morning and do it again tomorrow. It's like that, very blue collar. It doesn't matter how much intellectualism you have at all. That's secondary. What's primary is you get up every day and you go to work on it. And you work as hard as you possibly can all the way to the moment you go to sleep. And a lot of times I'd stay up an extra hour and a half. I did last night, stay up to like 1:30 in the morning, desperately trying to come up with some way to help people out. And just, you know, grind it, go away, grind it out every day. Without much reward, really. Just like you're just worker at a, you know, factory, coal miner, like a coal miner. Get up every day, go out on the mine, mine the coal, come home. What do you get out of it? Well, maybe a roof over your head, some food and roof over your head, and that's about it. You don't get any glamour. You don't get any rewards for getting that coal out of the ground. So it's like that. It's a blue-collar mentality. It's a work ethic mentality, which is all important. Now, America used to have that. Maybe that's what, one of the reasons I came here, is I wanted to tap into that Puritan work ethic, kind of very sober, very determined, very austere, not glamorous. You just work hard every day, and tapping into that part of America, which is what made America so prosperous, of course, is people just deferring the glamour of it all and just be willing to spend their lives just working like crazy. Eventually that builds up a lot of prosperity. But the people who built it up, they didn't take the time to enjoy it. No, they did not. They just kept working. So that's a very good example. Because you cannot take time to pat yourself on the back as you're going along on this path. Not much time at all. You got to get up in the morning, go to work. And you see the successes, but you say, yeah, that's great, but I know I have to go to work tomorrow too. I'm not finished, so it's just another day at the office. Just another day at the office, and no way around it. And you just get into that routine, and you just do it. But, everybody has a job anyway. So they got to go to the office, got to go to the coal mine, got to do something. Every day, get up, go to work. This is another day at the office, and you gotta come through. You gotta come through. So why not make the spiritual path your career? See, you're gonna have some career. Everybody has some career. So why make the spiritual path your career? That's what I did. This is my career. I'm determined to be successful at this career. And get up and you just work on it. That's it. And eventually, you're able to crack the toughest nuts. Even this high indifference. It's high indifference. You can see it and say, ah, okay. And when you do that, You feel like you've done something. But again, how do I feel now? I feel like now I gotta go spend the rest of the evening working as hard as I can, and then when I go to bed, I'm gonna spend as much time working before until I fall asleep, and then when I wake up early in the morning, I'm gonna spend hours working out in the morning, and then I'm gonna spend the entire day working out too. So tomorrow's gonna be just like today, like every day. That's exactly how I feel. And I'm sure I will feel that way until I actually exchange hypotheticals. No two ways about it. So, it is possible. That's what the report is. It is absolutely possible to recognize what our problem really is, what needs to be done, to understand the high indifference of the spiritual mentors, why they're that way, and it's all for our benefit, actually. And, so we will see what happens next. I know there's a lot of other tangents and things, but it's important to report on the positive developments. Very important. Because it's the positive developments that are going to be reassuring to us. Reassurance is what we ultimately need right now. Reassurance is what we ultimately need. I'm working on that level. Working on the level of reassurance. Everything else is filler. But if we don't have reassurance, we're going to have trouble. So we will keep working on that. And very great. That's it for this video.